Welcome to the Key Chapters of the Bible podcast. This is a daily podcast that's going through the key chapters of God's Word.
Well, hey, everyone. Welcome to episode 83 of our study, the Key Chapters of God's Word. And this chapter is a great reason for this podcast. This passage here that we're going to be looking at in 1 Kings chapter 18, it's a great example of what it means to be a person of faith, to trust God implicitly, to stand against the shifting trends of this world. In many ways, the situation of chapter 18 is very similar to our situation in our world today. The spiritual milieu of this whole passage here is one of rebellion and doubt in the Lord. The people are beginning to believe that maybe the gods of the Canaanites or the gods of their day were superior to the Lord, that somehow God's not giving them what they want, but these Canaanite gods will. And so the people of Israel begin to choose and follow these Canaanite gods for prosperity and provision. And here we're seeing God lovingly, mercifully calling them back to Him, calling them back to fellowship, back to His covenant promises, coming back to a restored relationship with Him. It's a great chapter. Let's dive into this passage here. Just reminding you of the context here, yesterday we were introduced to the prophet of Elijah. Elijah was the prophet to Israel. Remember, Israel is a northern kingdom. They had turned their back on God. And things were so bad in Israel at this point that their king named Ahab and his wife Jezebel were trying to make the national religion of all of northern Israel that of following Baal. I mean, just this incredible thing that the people of God would even be tempted to this, but they were. So God raises up Elijah to call the people back to Him. In chapter 17, we read just a few accounts of Elijah's resume. First, Elijah predicts that there's going to be a drought, and that's just going to show everyone that Baal is unable to help them. Second, the Lord miraculously provides food for Elijah at the brook of Cherith. Third, the Lord miraculously provides for Elijah's ministry when he's at the widow's house in Zarephath. And fourth, he brings the widow's son back to life. And so when chapter 18 opens, 3 years have now gone by. The Lord has been giving Ahab all of this time to repent, but he has not, even though Elijah's point's been made crystal clear. It's time for Ahab and for the people of God to acknowledge who is the true Lord and who is the imposter. And so this passage starts out with the Lord telling Elijah that it's time to address Ahab directly. So Elijah goes and gets a guy named Obadiah and tells him to bring a message to Ahab. Now, as a side note, this is not Obadiah the prophet. It apparently was a fairly common name back then in the Old Testament. There's several Obadiahs in the Old Testament. So this Obadiah here is a servant in Ahab's government, but he's also a follower of the Lord. And so when Elijah says to Obadiah, hey, can you bring a message back to Ahab for me? Obadiah is not real happy about this. He's protected the prophets in the past. He's not wanting to get on the bad side of Ahab. So eventually Elijah convinces Obadiah that you got to bring this message back. He reluctantly agrees. And Ahab and Elijah meet in verse 16, kind of 17. It's interesting how Ahab greets Elijah in verse 17. He says, oh, you're the troubler of Israel. Now, on the one hand, this is basically admitting that Elijah's prayers are working. Likewise, this is just this bold obstinance, as though somehow Elijah's the problem for bringing God's truth. Elijah says to him in verse 18, I have not made trouble for Israel, but you and your father's family have. You have abandoned the Lord's commands and have followed the Baals. And then Elijah gives Ahab this incredible challenge here. He says, go gather 450 prophets of Baal, 400 prophets of Asherah, and go to Mount Carmel. We're going to deal with things there. Man, Elijah's got some guts. Mount Carmel is back in this epicenter of Baal worship here. This is one of their sacred sites, and it's going to be a ratio of 950 prophets to one. Well, Ahab likes those odds, and so in verse 20, he sends a message throughout the land for the sons of Israel to gather with the prophets on Mount Carmel. And this just shows how the whole society was just so off the tracks. Man, they're willing to go see this thing, and maybe some were going and maybe hoping for the best for the Lord. But you just get this sense that they're all going to go see what is this all about. And there's just tremendous support here for Ahab and for Jezebel and for their false prophets. So in verse 21, they're all on Mount Carmel, and you just have this huge crowd of Jewish people watching this duel between Elijah and the prophets of Baal and Asherah. And this event's going to finally settle the question, who is God? Who is Israel's God? Who should we worship? Who should we obey? Who should we fear? Elijah even asked the people in this dramatic fashion in verse 21. He comes right up to the people, and you can just see him just saying to the crowd with this boldness, how long will you waver between two opinions? If the Lord is God, follow Him. But if Baal is God, follow him. But the people say nothing. And here we're just seeing this dynamic that James calls the double-minded person. This entire crowd here cannot take a stand one way or the other. They think that God's probably got some truth to him, but they think these false gods might as well. And so they're double-minded. They're following both the gods of their day as well as the true God himself. And so Elijah's question is simply stating the obvious. Just do what is real. And to help the people of Israel make this decision, Elijah challenges the prophets of Baal to see if their God's going to provide fire for the sacrifice. He says, basically, okay, here's the terms here. We're both going to make an offering to God, but without fire. Whichever God provides fire is the true God. What's interesting here is that I'm pretty sure at this point, the prophets of Baal are kind of all looking at each other saying, this isn't going to go real great. Because they probably know that when they call out to Baal, he really doesn't answer. They're just mostly just selling this prosperity message when there's really no truth behind it. But the people are like, yeah, that's a good idea. And so Elijah lets the prophets of Baal go first. And so this ceremony commences and the prophets of Baal are trying to make things work. Of course, they don't. And so Elijah starts giving them some silly encouragement, saying things like, hey, call out with a loud voice. Like maybe their God can't hear them. Or maybe he's occupied or on some journey and needs to be woken up. And you can imagine that probably was pretty frustrating to these prophets here. They start cutting themselves and blood is gushing everywhere. And there's still no voice and no answer from their God. And then Elijah calls the people to come near to him. He wants them to see what he's doing. This is not going to be a magic trick. Watch what I'm doing. Watch the water go everywhere. Watch this. And in verse 30, he takes 12 stones and rebuilds the altar to the Lord that they have torn down. Now, those 12 stones symbolically should have rested heavy on the people's hearts because that 12 was pointing them back to who they were as the chosen people of God. Remember, we saw yesterday, their entire nation is in rebellion to the Lord, but they could not rebel against their true nature as God's chosen people. And so he takes these 12 stones, he rebuilds the altar, he prepares the sacrifice, and then he has people pour all that water onto the wood, to the sacrifice, onto everything, just again, just to make sure nobody thinks he's just kind of flicking a match in there somehow. And so they pour water on a first time and a second time and a third time. So much water is just flowing all over the place. They're just going into the trench that they've dug around this thing. And the scene is set and is so clear that there's no way that Elijah can just make fire appear unless it's really going to be the Lord who does it. And so then at evening time, Elijah calls out to, and it's interesting, he calls out to the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel. Remember, Israel is another name for Jacob. We usually say the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. But here he says Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, because again, he's in this section where they have just rebelled against the Lord. And he says to them, let it be known that you are God in Israel. Again, not Baal, especially not where we are right now. You are the Lord. And he calls upon the Lord not only to answer his prayer, but to turn their hearts back to him. He's basically asking for a revival here. Well, the Lord hears his prayer and fire comes down and completely incinerates the offering, the wood, the stones, the dust, the water. It's all gone. And the people realize, okay, this is serious. And they fall before the Lord and they cry out, the Lord, he is God. The Lord, he is God. Just answering that question, who is God? It is Yahweh. It is the Lord. And so now that that question has been established, Elijah then has them execute these prophets and prepare for heavy rain. And by verse 45, they're deluged with this heavy storm. Now, the treatment here of the false prophets, it might seem like it's excessive to us, and I can understand that sentiment, but we need to remember that these false prophets were leading the people away from the true blessings of being in true fellowship with the true God. Not only that, but these false prophets were quite willing to execute the true prophets of the Lord, and so they had no problem killing God's prophets, and so this isn't really as much payback as it is that, you know what, if these guys are going to kill God's prophets, if they can't tolerate God's prophets, then they have to go. You know, there are a lot of people who claim to be prophets, and they somehow look to these kind of passages as somehow indications that they can be pretty much grouchy and difficult people to be around. But that's not Elijah's personality. Remember what we read yesterday in chapter 17, where he's caring for the widow and her son? He has such compassion on them. Likewise, we're going to see tomorrow in chapter 19 that he can get so discouraged, he's going to ask the Lord to take his life. And so when we take all these three chapters together, 17, 18, and 19, and we just look at the life of Elijah, we see here that godly men have a heart that is kind of compassionate to others, but they hold to God's truth without wavering. Well, so that's the passage here, and I'd like to make a couple comments on it before we go. For one thing, the whole point of this passage is to ask the question, who is God? God, the Lord, Yahweh is a true God. This passage shows us all of the emptiness of these other spiritual endeavors. No other false god can stand before the Lord. No other false god can provide for us what we need. God alone does these things, and we need to be looking to him even in our own day and age. Our society is saying there's so many other things we can go to for peace, prosperity, power, strength, and there's all kinds of things, spiritual things and worldly things that we can do. But this passage here is a reminder that only the Lord is true and real, and he is the only one who will give us these things, and we need to seek them from him in his time in submission to him. And when he doesn't give them to us, it's not as though he needs dancing and shouting and self-inflicted wounds to hear the prayers of his people. He is gracious and loving and compassionate and wants to give us the blessings he has ordained for us. And if he has chosen not to for a certain time or season, we just need to trust him and not go looking for those things from some other false god of this world. Also, notice the progression here. You would think that the Lord would just step on in and do this right away, but he doesn't. He waits until the people will fully realize there is no help coming from anywhere else. None of these other false gods are going to work. There are times that people basically come to passages like this and they cross their arms and say, you know what, if God does that, I'll believe him. If not, I'm not going to. But that's not really what's going on here. Through the sequence of events here, from the drought to this whole event on Mount Carmel, God has been showing the people, you cannot trust in any other God. They are not going to provide for you what you need. You need to come to me alone. And that's the place he wants to bring us. Not what we're saying, you know what, God, prove yourself. But rather, Lord, there is no other God beside you. Please help me. And that is the prayer that the Lord hears, and that's the prayer that he honors. This passage shows us God is a God of mercy. We need to remember here that God is going to people who are in direct rebellion to him. They're idol worshipers. But in his mercy, he is going out to them. He is showing them the futility of their God so they'll come back to him. And so often, that's what the Lord does in our life too. In our own life, there are people who are in this kind of same situation. And maybe like the crowds, if today, say Elijah were to go to the average person, maybe the average churchgoer in America and say, who is God? They might not keep silent like they do in this crowd, but they might say kind of sheepishly, well, I believe the Lord is God, but since he doesn't give me what I want, I'm looking for it elsewhere. And that's that double-mindedness that James was talking about. We need to come to the Lord and recognize that everything we would want can only come from God, whether it's peace or prosperity or power, if you want to, whatever you want to call that word power. That's what they're looking for back then. There are so many voices in this world saying, I can do this for you, I promise. God is calling us to come to this place where we say, you know what? I'm going to turn from all of that and follow God and trust him. And what he gives me, I'll rejoice in. And what he doesn't give me, I'll trust him. And that's the attitude of God's people when they come to him recognizing, I'm going to submit to you, God. And so as we end our time today, maybe just spend some time with the Lord and just bring all this before him and just say, Lord, is there anything in my life where I'm looking to something else besides you to give me something that I need? And maybe it's that peace, or maybe it's prosperity or something else. Lord, am I looking to anything else besides you? And just ask him to turn your heart back to him so that you would be single-minded, not double-minded, but single-minded, fully devoted to him and his will for your life. That's the place that we need to be, and that's the place that we'll see him working in our life. Well, we'll leave things there. Hope you have a great rest of your day. Hope to see you tomorrow. Thanks for listening again. God bless.